Thank you very much, everybody, and welcome to the first recital of this new academic year. This is week two of the quarter, and there are lots of very young people wandering around the campus looking very lost, but it's so nice to have all this young energy back here again. This year, we're going to have a few recitals here, the Christmas recital as usual, and the commencement recital. And we'll also be welcoming down here Christopher Keady from Grace Cathedral to give a recital in April. And if you're on the campus or in the area, as usual, every 2 weeks or so, I'm giving the lunchtime recitals here, Wednesdays at 12:15, so come back if you want more. Usually with these programs, I like to have some sort of thread running through them. This is not the case with this one. This is just pieces that I just love playing, and I think they're great fun. And also, some of them I learnt over the last year, so this is my report on what I did over my summer vacations. So funnily enough, for that first piece by Marcel Dupré, I mean, I wrote my doctoral dissertation on him, and I'd never played this one, Prelude and Fugue. And I'm just so glad I learned it, because it's such a good piece. And this is very much the piece by the young virtuoso. I mean, he was 24 when he wrote this. And you know, he wrote it during the gorgeous summer of 1910 in Paris. Going on, and so I'm going to frame this. The one interesting thing that I did find out about when I was researching these pieces is that three of them were written within about 6 years of each other. So this Dupré was written in 1910, the Parry that I'll play, the penultimate piece, 1913, and the final Willan, 1916. But I think what is so interesting is that 6 years separates them. They're very different stylistically. Very, very, very different indeed. But before that, I'm going to go up to the wonderful organ here by Charles Fiske, up in the middle, our Baroque style instrument, and play for you a piece about which I am absolutely passionate. It's from the Livre d'Orgue by Nicolas de Grigny. And it's this Récit de Thiers sans taille. Now that title is wonderful because it tells me exactly what stops to use. That the Thiers is a type of stop and it's in the tenor, so it's in my left hand. De Grigny, as you see from the program, didn't live long. And this one book of organ pieces is all he published in his lifetime. And it was published twice, once in Paris and once in Reims, where he was the organist at the cathedral there. But I think the fascinating thing about it is that there is also a copy of this book copied out by none other than Johann Sebastian Bach. So we know that Bach loved this music enough that he took the trouble to sit down and copy it out, ink on paper and all that. So you will hear right at the beginning this great big, it's a big, big gap. It's the right hand playing an A right up here, and the left hand playing an A right at the bottom, and nothing in the middle. So it starts with that very, very austere gap. And then a couple of bars later, the melody comes in the left hand. It's very ornate. De Grigny is always known for his pieces are difficult because of the ornamentation. So they're all over the place, and it's, you just gotta make it sound very relaxed and very improvisatory. But it's a wonderful piece, very, very poignant. Then I'm going to play a piece that I learned back earlier this year, and this is by, those of you who know me know that I have this love of early English keyboard music. And here is one of those composers, even though he had the good fortune to be born in Wales, but he moved soon to London and to Worcester, and had a very long career, did Thomas Tomkins, both as a musician in the Chapels Royal and as director of music at Worcester Cathedral. This offertory is an extraordinary piece. So it's about 16 minutes long, and it's based upon seven notes that you hear right at the beginning. And what I think is so amazing is the inventiveness of all these variations, because you think, oh boy, a piece over quarter of an hour long based on seven notes, but it's just amazing what he does rhythmically, and just the sense of growth as it goes along, because, you know, it starts very slowly in half notes, quarter notes join in, then eighth notes come along, and 16th notes come along, and then 32nd notes come along, and then right at the end, just when you think it's finishing, this great rush now of 12 notes per beat. So the very, very fast figuration to bring it to an end. So let me go up to the Fisk and play these two pieces for you. Then I'll come back down and play for you the Parry and the Willan. So here are these two extraordinary pieces by Nicolas de Grigny and Thomas Tomkins. Thank you very much.
very much. I must say, I find that such an extraordinary piece of music.
The interesting thing about it, as it's called an offertory, and the offertory was always the longest part of the service. You know, when the bread and the wine are brought up to the altar, and the priest begins the act of consecration. So there was music to cover that. So that's why this piece is so long. But the interesting thing, at odd parts in the piece, he writes little fermatas for nobody knows why. But one theory is that maybe those are just places where you can stop. If everything's finished, here's a good place to stop. So it could be as practical as that. And also, I think what is so amazing about it is the fact that it's in one tonality all the way through, but you never get tired of the sound of it. You're never aware of the fact that, oh, hold on, this piece isn't modulating. It's not going anywhere. But I think you never get tired of that. So now on to Charles Hubert Hastings Parry, a great composer of the late 19th and early 20th century and a great teacher. He was for many years head of the Royal College of Music in London. And as you can see, he died in 1918. And it's a well-known fact that as head of the Royal College of Music, he saw, between 1914 and 18, a whole generation of young men and young composers killed. You know, some of the last pieces he wrote, the last great choral piece he wrote, are called the Songs of Farewell, and they're wonderful. They're just lovely. Do go and listen to them. This elegy he wrote in 1913 for the funeral of a friend of his. And It's in the beautiful key of A flat major. What a lovely key. And earlier on, I was just thinking back to the slow movement from the Beethoven Pathetique Sonata. And I just want you to think of that Beethoven when you hear the first two bars of this piece. I think there are amazing similarities. Straight from the Parry, I will go on to the extraordinary introduction, Passacaglia and Fugue by Healey Willan. Unless you're an organist or a church musician, this is going to be a name that will not mean anything to you at all. He was born in London, but at a young age moved to Canada, where he settled in Toronto. And he wrote a lot of really well-written anthems and chorale preludes for organ. But it's this piece just stands out from everything else. You'll hear, again, the language is not that of somebody from the borough of Balham in London. This is music harkening back very much to the German post-romantic composer Max Reger. And indeed, Reger wrote an introduction, Passacaglia and Fugue, in E minor. And that was very much the model of what Willan wanted to do with this piece. There are sketches to suggest that it was going to be in E minor, but eventually he settled into E flat minor, which is a very, very gritty key indeed. You will hear right at the beginning these very, very strange series of very, very quiet chords before full organ bursts forth. The introduction goes through a great amount of drama before it leads into the Passacaglia. So like the Tomkins that we just heard, we're going to hear a set of variations on a theme. And these are wonderful variations. Again, I know I use the word inventive too much, but these are just wonderful. and they conclude, the music gets very fast and very vigorous, but then at one point everything stops, and on the solo reed, very loud, you'll tell, he writes, Marcia Funebre, funeral march. So, you know, that's the sort of atmosphere he's trying to conjure at that stage of the piece. There is a very gentle transition, which takes us then into the final fugue. This is a beautifully written fugue. It's textbook, but incredibly dramatic, and builds into such a great whirlwind. And then, right in the penultimate page, everything comes to a stop, and it certainly suddenly turns from E-flat minor into E-flat major, and you hear these wonderful bits of filigree in the right hand, and it goes and goes and goes until you get the final theme in the pedals, full organ, and in the manual's big 8 and 10 note chords, and it comes to a very triumphant close. So thank you for being here. Thank you very much for being here this evening. I do need to point out one bit of housekeeping, which is these recitals are free of charge, and we love to keep them this way. So if you can donate, you will find a QR code in the program and on a sign out in the vestibule. But yes, thank you for helping us to keep this series free of charge. It's the only such concert series on the campus. So here's the elegy by Hubert Parry and the introduction Passacaglia Fugue by Healey Willan. Thank you very much.